We all rely on farmers and ranchers, but farming is riskier than other businesses out there. Crop insurance helps farmers manage their risk. With crop insurance, farmers put skin in the game by paying premiums and shouldering deductibles. That keeps taxpayers from having to pick up the whole bill every time disaster strikes. Today, about 90% of U.S. farmland is insured, providing $100 billion in protection to more than 130 different kinds of crops. It's a testament to the program's success.
Thank you for joining us for our AgriPulse Washington Week in Review. I'm Spencer Chase, joined as always by AgriPulse Senior Editor Phil Brasher, discussing the week that was, agriculturally speaking, in Washington, D.C. And in Washington, D.C. this week, we got the news that we've been waiting for a while, all of you have been waiting for a while, and once it started, man, it really started. House and Senate Conference Committee on the Farm Bill released the text of their conference agreement on Monday night. The Senate turned around and voted on the agreement Tuesday, and then the House did their work on Wednesday. And here we sit on Thursday. We don't know what we're supposed to do. Our lives have been so consumed by the Farm Bill for the last couple of weeks, months, a couple of years, really, that this is a bit of a turning of a page, not only for Congress, but for the people that cover agriculture in Congress as well. But Phil, not only did the House and Senate pass this Farm Bill, they really passed this Farm Bill.
They did. There were landslides in both the House and the Senate. We had sort of expected that in the Senate. It was a little less clear in the House what would happen, but yeah, you had 87-13 was the vote in the Senate, the largest number of votes for a farm bill in the Senate in history. The margin in the House was even slightly larger, I believe 47 votes against it, 44 Republicans and 3 Democrats, really remarkable.
Mm-hmm. So we saw historic vote margins in both chambers of Congress for this Farm Bill. And we were talking here just a little bit ago about some of the changes that are within this Farm Bill. You know, we obviously talked a lot about the things in the nutrition title, the debate therein, and whether or not how that would impact the vote. Obviously, that was a big factor. But also, a lot of other things in this bill that attracted some Democratic support.
Yeah. Now, I talked to one of the leading Democrats, Jim McGovern from Massachusetts, shortly ago about that. And I asked him how much the fact that the Democrats won on the welfare reform issue, the SNAP reforms, they defeated those, how much that had to do with the big votes. And he said it had to do a lot. But another factor has to be, Spencer, as you talked about, the number of new programs and new spending in this bill for non-traditional forms of agriculture and organic agriculture, and permanent funding baseline in a number of these cases, for locally produced foods, for indoor urban agriculture. Industrial hemp is legalized in this bill and made eligible for crop insurance. This brings on, you know, a fair number of votes, fair number of regions that really, in areas, even cities, that have not had an interest in farm programs per se, now they do.
And not only was there a good deal of Democratic support on the bill, a very minute deal of Republican opposition to it. As you all remember, earlier this spring, the House Freedom Caucus kind of led an effort to essentially sink the farm bill on the House floor over an immigration spat, and they were essentially the only ones that voted against the bill on the House floor this time around.
They really were, and we've seen organizations, a number of organizations around town, including the Heritage Foundation, have spent the last several years trying to build a case for cutting the commodity programs, cutting crop insurance, and also addressing the food stamp program. And these organizations didn't change their position, but they were defeated very soundly in these votes.
Mm-hmm. So the Farm Bill passed. Next step, of course, is to get a signature from the President of the United States. We don't have an exact time and date to offer it to you on that point, but we do know at this point that the President is expected to sign the bill next week, still awaiting some specifics in that regard. But I think I can say comfortably that I would be shocked if he didn't sign the bill.
There's no question. And I think it's also safe to say that the House and Senate could easily override it if he just happened to decide that he didn't like it, but that's not going to happen. It actually takes several days for the bill, the paperwork, actually to get to the White House. That'll probably be next week before that happens, and then we'll have the president sign it.
Mm-hmm. So we'll be sure to keep you up to date in terms of when that happens. But I want to talk about some other things that happened at the White House this week. If you are a human being in the United States with an internet connection, you probably heard about a meeting that happened earlier this week between President Donald Trump and Democratic leaders of the House and Senate, Nancy Pelosi and Chuck Schumer. They went there to discuss strategy to potentially avoid a government shutdown, and that ended up becoming an argument in front of the press. Cameras were rolling, microphones were functional. So we learned a lot in that moment. But the moral of the story here, as we sit here right now recording, government funding is set to expire next Friday. And Phil, unless, you know, everyone can sit around the campfire and sing kumbaya on this, there's looking like a potential for a shutdown of a number of government departments next Friday.
Yeah, and a lot of the government is actually funded through the rest of the fiscal year until September 30th of next year. But there are some notable exceptions, and just so happens that nearly all of the exceptions have are important to agriculture. USDA, FDA, EPA, the Interior Department. None of them have their actual FY19 budgets yet. And they're caught up in this, as well as some policy issues related to those departments. However, as you say, the government runs out of funding December 21st, so stay tuned.
Right, we're not really in the handicapping business here at Agri-Pulse, but next week we'll say with confidence next week will be interesting based on a lot of the discussion that needs to happen in order to avoid a complete government shutdown. A lot of other things to happen here before the end of the year, in theory, of course, still waiting on an announcement from the Department of Agriculture in rounds to that second round of payment on the market facilitation program, the trade assistance package for the nation's producers impacted by the trade dispute. Still waiting on a final word on that front from what we're hearing. It's a bit of a, you know, discussion between the White House and the Department of Agriculture at this point. We'll be sure to keep you up to date on that front. But we also have seen some developments on the China trade market. The Department of Agriculture confirming this morning that China has bought 1.13 million tons of U.S. soybeans for exports to that country. So some developments there to keep an eye on here in the next couple of weeks, and certainly some things to keep AgriPorter types busy. But for now, we've got the news that we've been waiting for all year. The Farm Bill is passed. It's on the way to the President's desk. We appreciate all of you patronizing our website for coverage of this event throughout the year. And we look forward to bringing you comprehensive coverage of implementation of this new legislation and all of the other various ag policy comings and goings here in the next couple of weeks and months. But I think that's going to do it for this week's Week in Review. For Phil Brasher, I'm Spencer Chase. Have a good one.